Thank you very much, Tuck, and thank you again to the Keynes Fund for funding this work. What we're interested in is who gets access to highly effective, good, outstanding schools in a situation where obviously there are scarce resources in our public education system. And we're going to be looking at that in the context of England, which has, as I'm sure you're all aware, a parental choice, a school choice model of pupil allocation to schools. For the school choice system to work effectively, obviously a number of things need to hold. And the first being that parents really must have genuine choice. In other words, they must be able to access more than one school. And the allocation mechanism by which pupils are allocated to schools on the basis of the choices that parents want to make is key to the whole system. And I'll come back to that in a moment. We also need parents to care about quality. So if schools value academic standards, then theoretically a parental school choice model could potentially increase quality and indeed efficiency. But of course, if parents value things other than academic standards, this could be a problem. For example, evidence from the US about valuing ethnic composition of schools is not likely to drive up standards. And then in terms of the market working, we need good information for parents to make sensible decisions, and they have to have a reasonable probability of getting their preferred school. In other words, there has to be some potential for excess capacity in the system so that a parent expressing a preference, expressing a choice, has a reasonable chance of getting that school because there's some capacity, excess capacity built in. And then on the other side, we need schools to be responding to this market. And for that, we obviously need them to benefit from increased numbers of applications. That means per capita funding, of course. But we also need them to be able to adjust to meet demand. In other words, a highly effective school needs to be able to expand. So the questions we're trying to answer with this project are, on the constraint side of things, what schools can parents really access? Because as I'll explain in a moment, that determines whether the system is really operating as a school choice system. We also need to better understand what parental preferences look like. In other words, what is it about, in this case, secondary schools that parents really value? And is it academic standards? And to what extent do both the constraints that parents face and their preferences vary considerably across different dimensions of parental type, if you like, and particularly across socioeconomic backgrounds. So we're interested in the heterogeneity in both the constraints and the preferences. As you can imagine, there's a number of methodological problems with trying to study this issue. The most fundamental one, of course, is that in England, for example, parents are given a form. They can express a preference about which school their child might attend or they want their child to attend. The problem with that is that if they don't have a chance of getting into a great school that they like, they're not going to put it on the form, of course. And so the actual choices they make are not their real preferences. They are the preferences constrained by reality. And this is obviously a complicated issue. In England, the allocation, the algorithm used to allocate pupils to schools is truth revealing. So if parents were to be given an infinite number of choices for the school that they wish their child to attend, it would be fine because they would, the mechanism for allocating pupils is truth revealing. But the problem is that parents are not given an unlimited number of choices. And indeed, in many areas, they can only make three choices. And so that tends to provide an incentive to nominate a safe school that they think they can get their child into as opposed to their preference. And that's why it's difficult to uncover the genuine parental preference. So we're following an existing literature on this. There are lots of ways you can think about modeling this. We're doing it as a discrete choice model, following Flack et al. And indeed our previous work, where we essentially define a feasible choice set for each individual child. So taking the child's perspective, which schools can they feasibly access? And then within that feasible choice set, what is the ranking of parental preference to be revealing? So the contribution that the project will make is first of all, that we're using administrative data on parents' preferences and parents' choices of schools for their children. So we have the population data for this. So in other words, we have the choices made on the form by every parent in England for 2 years. And so we can use that data to look at the preference side of things. We're also doing a huge amount of primary data collection, which sadly has been rather affected by COVID, but we're nearly there. Primary data collection on the admissions criteria of each secondary school in England, because it's only when we understand the admissions criteria, and particularly whether they're oversubscribed and the importance of any geographic criteria, that we can then determine which schools the child had a reasonable chance of being able to access. And once we've defined that feasible choice set, we can then look at how parents' preferences drive the choices within that feasible choice set. So eventually we're going to be able to document how school choice varies across geographies, across different population densities, and particularly across the distribution of school quality. And PATHAC highlighted this as an issue that we really need to understand more about, not just parental preferences, but how preferences and constraints, or admissions priorities as they're called, co-vary with other characteristics of the education market. So going back to the primary data collection that we've done, it's no small task, obviously, collecting data on the admissions criteria of every school in England, or every secondary school in England. But it's vital. And I think there are a couple of things to note on this. First of all, every school is bound by an admissions code. So schools can't make up sort of random admissions criteria. They can't use, the color of your hair or interviews. But they can, however, have very variable admissions criteria within the constraints of the code. And they can have different priorities for different criteria. So when we have documented this and collected the primary data on this, it's very clear that there's a lot of different practices across schools. And one of the big challenges has been to determine geography and the extent to which geography limits choice. So we've constructed catchment area boundaries where appropriate for schools, and also the straight line distance of the last child that was offered a place at that school. Just as an important aside, obviously, this is the kinds of information that we're expecting parents to be able to process in order to determine whether or not they think their child can attend a particular school. So we don't have a lot of time, I know, but I thought it'd be useful to sort of run through some of the empirical findings that we've got so far. The obvious one is parents are using the choice system. In other words, they're not just making the choice, one choice or linear school. The average number of choices is 2.4, but that's artificial because it turns out that half of parents or half of households are capped in terms of the number of choices they can make at 3. The rest of the country gets to make generally up to 6 choices, but half the population can only make 3. And of those who can only make 3, about a third make the maximum number of choices. So that kind of implies that there's a constraint in there that's binding. Certainly not everyone is choosing their nearest school, only about just under 40% choose their nearest school. But I think the really important feature emerging from our data is that the families who have larger numbers of choices are certainly being more ambitious. And by ambition, I mean choosing higher quality schools as measured by standardized test scores. So in other words, given a rather less binding constraint on the numbers of options that you can take, families feel more confident in expressing arguably their true preference for a very good school as their number one choice. And that also, the flip side of that, suggests that some households are not expressing their preference due to limited numbers of choices. In terms of the admissions criteria of school, it's been fascinating. We knew that it was a big data collection exercise in terms of sort of just the sheer number of schools that we have to go and get information from. But what has become increasingly apparent is it's also incredibly difficult to navigate, difficult to extract the information, and very complex. So there are large numbers of criteria being used by different schools. Lots of schools lack information on whether they're oversubscribed, but even more crucially, they definitely lack information on geographical proximity and the importance of that. Now, we've been able to construct that in various different ways, but the reason for highlighting this is if parents don't have clear, easy to access information on the geographic side of things, then of course it's going to be very difficult for them to make sensible choices if those are very constrained by the information they have. And so if nothing else, we've got to the stage where we can clearly see information failure as a potential weakness. So I said we had population data. So we have population data on all the choices made by all the parents trying to get their children into a state secondary school. We can obviously link that to the characteristics of schools, and we've also linked it to other data from the regulator, Ofsted, which gives an indication of the quality of school, or a judgment, if you like, on the quality of school. And we've used that to try and answer a very basic question at this stage, which is the extent to which access to the better schools, good outstanding schools, is varying according to postcode. So this is, again, just simple descriptives here. As we move from left to right, we have the most deprived neighbourhoods in terms of the bottom decile, as measured by the index of multiple deprivation, moving across the piece to the least deprived neighbourhoods. And you can see that particularly in that bottom decile, those children in the poorest neighbourhoods have access to far fewer numbers of good and outstanding schools. This is perhaps what you expected. Equally, when you move into the middle of the distribution, you can see that there isn't a lot of variation in terms of access to good and outstanding schools once you get out of those very low income neighbourhoods. I'm sure you appreciate that the level of deprivation and the nature of the area in which people live are highly correlated with lots of deprived areas in urban and major cities. So we've also illustrated this by breaking it out into different types of conurbations. So we've got, you know, urban major conurbation on the left, right through to a more sparsely populated rural village on the right. We've also modelled this, of course, in a regression context, controlling for all of this simultaneously, including local authority fixed effects. And what I'm about to say holds up in a regression context, but this seemed an easy way to illustrate the point. Again, what you're seeing is, particularly in urban areas, this major difference between the number of schools that children in more advantaged neighbourhoods can access versus the number of schools that people in the most deprived neighbourhoods can actually access. So when we're looking at the constraints, even though theoretically a parent in those very low income neighbourhoods can make a choice of school and they can choose any school they want, in reality, when we start to construct these feasible choice sets, they are more constrained than children in more advantaged neighbourhoods. And obviously, the other fairly obvious point is that those who live rurally have access to far fewer schools. You'll also notice that in rural areas in particular, it is that most advantaged neighbourhood decile, right at the top end, that access a large number of good and outstanding schools. So there are two separate issues there that need consideration. In terms of where we've got to, so we've managed to collect primary data from almost all the schools, secondary schools in England. We're nearly there, and we hope to be there just about by the end of the project. And what we've done so far, of course, is just simply document who gets access to which schools, and also to document parental preferences taking the form as a revealed preference. Our next stage is to bring those two things together and simultaneously model preferences and constraints in a discrete choice model context. And there are still issues with that, of course. One of the things that we're trying to work around is the fact that a lot of schools use sibling indicators as a criteria. And we don't have data on whether or not the child has a sibling in the school. But we do have survey information that does include that information and also includes endogenous moves where people are relocating in order to be geographically proximate to a good and outstanding school. So those are two issues that we're going to be working on shortly. What we have uncovered so far is very clear, though, from a policy perspective, quite useful. Despite the admissions code and the requirement to publish information about the admissions criteria of every school, there are clearly still information failures. And it's been far too hard to get that data, suggesting that many parents are kind of working blind in the school choice system. We also think that artificially constraining half the country to only making three choices is both unnecessary and suboptimal. It would be cheap and efficient to increase those numbers of choices to six at least, like the rest of the country, and we would see some improvement in sorting there simply because parents could make more ambitious choices. And then the other thing that's become apparent in some of the descriptives I've shown you is that the constraint side of things are a major issue, and that despite having parental choice, children from different backgrounds, particularly in the poorest neighbourhoods, simply don't have access to the same number of good and outstanding schools that they do in wealthier neighbourhoods. So I'll stop there. Thank you.